Hello. Tonight you are going to experience a new form of media, an alternative approach to information. It's being developed by different groups of young people who want to redefine how we view television. Their work is usually found in video stores or on the internet, but tonight you can find it on the National. One of its pioneers is a Toronto-based company called Channel Zero. We ask them to show us what's on their minds, and what they came up with is an issue that concerns us too. Tonight, we begin the first of their three investigative programs on the electronic eye, Canada as a Surveillance Society. This is part one, the Mondex Scenario.
Prophets, seers, and doomsday economists have all predicted the imminent apocalypse of our modern monetary system and the birth of the cashless society. As the millennium draws to a close and prophecies begin to take on an eerie significance, one multinational corporation has bet its very existence on the universal acceptance of smart card technology that will ultimately abolish the commodity formerly known as cash.
You see, you don't get something for nothing in this life. The human condition is such that whatever we want has to be paid for with something else we want. And so the question is not, should you have safety? Should you have convenience? Should you have security? Of course you should. The question is, how much are you prepared to sacrifice of people's freedoms in order to get it? Because we also want freedom.
I believe that in the future, everybody will have a smart card. And this will not just be a card with money on it, it will have multi-use.
There's no reason to think that you couldn't have one smart card that was your MasterCard, as well as your debit card, as well as your Mondex stored value card, as well as your welfare benefits card, as your health card, and your driver's license, and your student card, and your library card, and so on and so forth. I mean, all of that information can be digitized, and in fact, don't take up a lot of memory, and memory is cheap, so you could have one universal smart card. And I'm sure people at companies like Mondex are vying for that position in the marketplace to be the one dominant universal smart card.
What I have here is the Mondex smart card with the microchip on the front of the card. Okay, right. This is where your purse is, where your value would be stored when you've moved money from your bank account onto your card.
Love to say, nothing is inevitable so long as we're prepared to pay attention. It's paying attention. It's figuring out what questions to ask, what properties of the medium to look at, how it is that this is having its impact on us as individuals, on us as households, on us as whole cultures and societies, on us as an overall planet.
The currency of the day is literally always what is most current. So at one time it was seashells, then it was metal, then it was paper, then it was plastic. Now what is most current today is information technology and bits and microchips.
In terms of predictions, we came in expecting 300 merchants. And our target is 8,000 to 10,000 consumers. We've exceeded the merchants. We have 500 merchants. We're in the early days with the card holders. We're just starting to go out to the general public. So our target is still 8 to 10,000 people would have the card and using it by the end of the year.
Well, we just had our bank representative come around. They said that they had like a one-year free like pilot mission, whatever, just a trial. So we said, well, we'll try it, but we haven't actually used it yet, to be honest.
When we first introduced debit, people said, well, I have credit cards, why do I need debit cards? Now we're introducing electronic cash, people say, well, I have credit and debit, why do I need electronic cash? And what we find is that each of these systems do something different for you, and people ultimately want the choice and convenience. So based on the research we've done, and it was quite extensive, we expect very good acceptance and usage of Mondex.
They were very probing. They were asking, what were my sales systems now? Did I use cash, check, credit card? Preferences all the way along, where I shop, that type of thing, to see who they could target.
Well, there's huge amounts of money being thrown at this because there's a lot of money to be made from this. If you get your foot in the door first, you've essentially established a monopoly. They've got a lot of money to throw at a community. They've got a lot of money to throw at through a PR firm. They have a purpose. They want to, get their foot in the door at Guelph, and once they've done that, they're wanting to use that to be able to get into other communities.
Mondex is the only reloadable cash card that lets you do person-to-person transfers. The others don't do that. Today, Mondex is the only one that lets you have the home accessibility. It really is leading edge.
It gives you access to physical cash versus the telephone banking that you're able to do now by paying bills over the phone, et cetera, et cetera. This is giving you cash in your hand. So we term them Mondex moments, but you think about the time that the pizza guy's at the door and you're $2 short. You'll have the capability of getting that $2 from your bank account rather than opening up the piggy bank and counting all those pennies, putting it on your card and paying the delivery man.
Mondex, the two banks, came to the city and said, we would like to become and use Guelph as the pilot community. Is this something that would be of interest to you? Would you be amenable to it?
I don't think that's the notion they're approaching this as a test. It's a test of the best way to make you swallow it, because you're not going to have a choice about swallowing this. And they're going to shove it down your throat, and they simply want to find out the best way to distract you.
When the banks first decided this, they came in and talked to council sort of quietly and explained to them in a fair amount of detail what Mondex was all about, and really tried to emphasize the positive things of Mondex and the benefit that it would bring to the city.
My understanding was that the city, in turn, said, we're not endorsing it, we're not going to endorse your product or service, but if you'd like to come into the community and do it, that's okay.
The recommended motion was for us to support, and they didn't describe it as being Mondex in the motion, as an alternative financial mechanism, or I can't remember the exact wording. That motion was changed, I know, to read enthusiastically support, and then it also gave direction to the city administrator to cooperate with this endeavor.
Mondex has been helping the city in terms of parking meters and the bus operations and some of the snack bar operations, in providing some upfront funding to get us into new equipment that will allow us to make use of the Mondex cards.
We learned last week at a committee of council that there's going to be the conversion of the fare ticket collection system so that they were able to take the Mondex cards. I guess I can see that as being part of what Mondex is trying to do, so that you can use the Mondex cards on the buses. However, we also learned that the city's share of that is going to be $15,000. I've got a problem with that. I don't think that city taxpayers should be paying for the conversions of parts of their buses, basically, essentially, to provide a monopoly for a private business endeavor. If they want to pay for the whole thing, then fine, they can pay for the whole thing.
The reason that we're sharing the cost is from a couple of points of view. One, if we can get new equipment on the bus, and if we can eliminate or significantly reduce the amount of cash that we're taking on the bus, We presently have about 1.5 to 2 people full-time that count cash from the buses. If I'm not taking that cash from the buses, I can reduce my staff costs through not having to count as much cash. In addition to that, by Mondex coming in, they've made a commitment at this stage to provide a significant amount of advertising on the buses for Mondex specifically, and it's quite a large amount.
I have no idea anything about it. I don't even pretend to. Sitting there on the bus when I got on Friday, I don't wait. Oh, take a sitting here. I don't know if it's working, it isn't working, or nothing. All I know is take a sitting here.
Modernity is a story of institutions becoming more and more distant from the people that they're supposed to serve and becoming more and more opaque, so that you get this kind of Kafkaesque vision of the bureaucracy, which is constantly deflecting you when you're trying to understand what's going on and how your life is being impinged upon by the actions of institutions, in particular the state. But not just the state. Increasingly now it's business and corporations which are opaque. So the response then is not to make them less opaque, but rather to hire these people who will speak to us from those places. So we get PR people for corporations, we get spokespeople for governments, and they're our single conduit from the institution and to our own lives. Can we trust what they tell us? Of course we can, because we have no way of verifying it. There's no independent means of matching that against reality. That is the reality we get. That's all we get. So this idea that the spin doctor, right, the salesperson, it's not just about consumer culture. I mean, we're being sold things 24 hours a day in terms of products, but we know that. We're also being sold ideas. We're being sold our lives in various ways by these people who speak from institutions to us.
When you do have a legitimate product or a service, or you want to represent yourself, really what's required is, okay, then expose yourself. Tell people who you are and what you're doing and why you're doing it.
Mondex has met with us, CIBC and Royal Bank, and in that respect they've been talking to us and trying to get us to understand it and support it. But I think for students, it's an advertising campaign around the university and around Guelph in general.
I think we're seeing the confusion of the role of governance and the role of commerce. And in the world of commerce, you're dealing with consumers. In the world of governance, you're dealing with citizens.
I don't even really like using Interact, just because I don't like banks. I find that they scam a lot and they take a lot of money that's unnecessary.
This method of changing things when people don't really want change is taught in business schools as a method for taking over corporations. You take the corporation, you move in, and you change everything in 24 hours. You don't do it the first 24 hours necessarily. You wait till you've got everything ready, and then you go, boom, just change everything. And the disorder is so great that you're the one who knows where you're going and what you're doing, and so you get what you want.
We think Mondex is more than cash, and so we've changed ours into Mondex is simply more than money. And you talk about things you can't do with money as opposed to it just equals money.
When paper money exchanges hands, no third party gets a piece of the action. But with Mondex, that changes. Mondex gets a piece of the action.
The other device that we have is the wallet. Okay, and the wallet would be used to move money from card to card, from chip to chip.
When you load electronic money onto your Mondex card, instantly money is taken out of your own bank account and put into a Mondex account. And it sits there until you go to various retailers, pay out the electronic money off your Mondex system, and then eventually those retailers will go back to the bank and ask to be reimbursed. That period of time where the money is sitting in the Mondex account is called the float, and essentially you've given Mondex an interest-free loan. So at any time, if you think of the hundreds of thousands of Mondex customers that there may be with using electronic money floating around the system, that's going to add up to a few million dollars at a time, perhaps. We'll be right back.
It also allows me to track the last 10 transactions where I've spent money, because that information is stored on the card. It's not stored anyplace else.
And if you sign up for the program, you get most of this stuff for free. And so they've got to make their money somewhere. And I think it's going to be about selling the information, because if they can actually break down to how much I actually spend on entertainment, that becomes that much more valuable to somebody else.
If you read a recent issue of Marketing News, for example, you'll see that merchants like smart cards. Why? Because they act as tracking devices. It's precisely because of the tracking device aspect, that is, that the marketer can follow the trail, the footprints that you leave every time you make a purchase or a phone call or whatever it is. The fact that they can follow it is very attractive, because it means they can build up a personal profile on you, the customer.
Names and addresses have huge, huge market value these days. People often say, it's only my name and address, what's the big deal? Your name and address fuels a multi-billion dollar direct marketing industry. It's the raw material for a $75 billion industry in the United States and $11 billion a year business in Canada. So names and addresses and personal information have great market value.
Certainly databases are not autonomous. Every time data is collected on a big system, that system costs an awful lot of money to put into place. It's technically very, very sophisticated and very expensive, and it has very specific purposes, whether it's set up for to try to track welfare fraud or to track consumer profiles.
All of this technology has made the collection, manipulation, and trafficking in personal information much easier and much more profitable, and therefore much more attractive to business. The individual who provides this information, that's you and me and all the millions of us, have almost nothing to say about what happened to us thereafter.
The cashless society is a conflict between our desire for efficiency and our fear of outside control. I think there is an ethical requirement on companies to explain themselves more, to explain why they want this kind of data, why they want to make these kinds of profiles. It seems to me irresponsible.
I want you to use it for this purpose, for this transaction, and that's it. I don't want you to sell it to another company for marketing purposes. Or if you do, I want you to get my consent first.
There is a level of skepticism that's being discussed at the university right now around the issue of privacy, what information is linked to the cards, and who will have access to that information.
We are very, very careful about our customers' information and how it's handled. So we don't sell customer information for anything.
The bank, for privacy reasons, won't disclose your personal information to your supermarket, but they will disclose summary statistics. Who has a big mortgage, who has a big car loan. So banks do sell that information to supermarkets, for example.
The issue of database sharing or database matching and warehousing is the coming battleground for privacy protection, both in the public and the private sector. There are enormous quantities of highly sensitive and intimate personal information about all of us now contained in data banks all over the place.
And with the growth of the internet and networked communications, you're not going to have any ability to access that information and try to correct it if it's incorrect. And that's a huge problem.
The corporation has an economic interest and, in fact, a duty to their shareholders, we should recognize, to exploit the system as much as they can financially. And so if transaction records of people's purchases has value and Mondex is legally allowed to sell it, they should sell it. And if they don't sell it, they're being negligent to their shareholders.
So we have the wallet reading card one or card two.
You see, so often what happens, these things become something like the sorcerer's apprentice. We create the instrument. There's a legitimate reason for it, but the instrument goes on and becomes a monster in its own right. And largely because we didn't create the safeguards at the time, we didn't address ourselves, we didn't ask the hard questions, we just looked at the convenience, the administrative convenience, or whatever other legitimate objective had to be resolved, but we didn't face the price that may have to be paid.
Essentially, we are on the cusp of the issue. We are at the point where the technologies are now available to collect the most intimate details of our medical background, our genetic makeup. We are at the point at which governments and the private sector have tools like smart cards, like building data warehouses, which can assemble all of this material.
But we do not have the policies, the legislation, the understandings that will allow us to maintain control over that. And it's like time bombs waiting to go off. And, you know, we will, you know, find ourselves down the line waking up, I think, to the fact that we have lost a great deal of the control of information.
In Swindon, in the UK, Mondex had a test run similar to what they're doing now in Guelph, Ontario. A group like ours called Privacy International was concerned about whether the Mondex technology was truly anonymous, which is how Mondex was describing it at the time. It was anonymous just like cash. And they filed in a court an action claiming that Mondex was guilty of false advertising. And in the end, Mondex had to admit that in fact their system wasn't anonymous, and they withdrew the word anonymous from all of their public relations. And if you look carefully at the material that Mondex is distributing describing their test run in Guelph, you won't find the word anonymous.
You are literally defenseless when it comes to your privacy in the private sector, in the commercial sector. There are almost no laws, except in Quebec, which cover what they do with your information. So you and I and all the rest of us are going naked before the world, believe me.
The question comes to mind is, do we have the time or care to make those decisions? Those are difficult decisions and involve taking responsibility. And I think most of us feel so poorly informed, so poorly have access to such little information that we just decide, I don't know. You know, I don't know the truth anymore, and I just prefer, I'd prefer for someone else to make those decisions for me.
If we as citizens sit back and let things just take their course, sit back and let those who would profit from these machines without any concern for those they may hurt or displace in the process, if we sit back and just let bureaucrats in Ottawa or anywhere else in this country simply make the decisions, we're kidding ourselves about what kind of society and future we're going to end up with.
The cashless society is a conflict between our desire for efficiency and our fear of outside control. So we like the idea of the cash card, now we like the idea of Interac, because it means it's more convenient for us to acquire goods in various ways. You know, we go and have our consumer transactions and they're made smoother, they're made less frictionful. But at the same time, we have this nightmare vision, which is apocalyptic, of some external force controlling us in a way by seizing our assets. So the scenario from Margaret Atwood's novel.